All right, why don't we call the meeting to order, 7:03 PM. Alicia, wink, wink, would you like to be an ad hoc CPAC member today, tonight? Thank you. So we're gonna call this meeting to order. I would move that we put table the old business to the next business meeting and not bother with any of that. And we start with, maybe Carolyn, if we start with a quick update on a couple of the items, then we can move into the report of the kind of meat of the meeting. We do have RCTV here recording, so smile pretty and speak up, because I know people ask us if we're recorded tonight. We will.
Do we have a microphone?
We are.
Oh, it's on there. Only
yes,
right now.
So speak loudly. We're not live streaming, so don't worry, but it will be recorded on the website. Okay. So, Carolyn, if we want to start with, if you want to give a quick update on staffing, and then we can move through a couple of the other agenda items.
Sure. We have one team chair that is going to be leaving us, our Birch Barrows team chair, so we're in the process of filling that position. Otherwise, all of our team chair positions are full. We have hired the CBA. We should be starting on Monday, so once that's all finalized, our second BCBA, we'll be getting that information up. So those are some of the basic staffing.
Can I ask, because it's been asked to me, the Birch Meadow team chair, when she ends?
We don't have a final plan yet.
Okay, will that be announced?
Yeah.
Once we have the details, but we'll need to work through that.
Any other staffing things? So that was something we've been working on last year, making sure we have descriptions of all the various programs in place, including kind of cohort of children, learning profiles, that kind of stuff. Is there an update you can share on where you are with those?
I believe I shared with you the form that we're going to ask each program to utilize. So we have a standard form, and so our teachers during vertical time that they have this year will be working on that. We don't have as much time this year for our teachers to do that collaboration, so I'm not sure on a timeline, just because there are other things people need to do. So
I think we had talked about having them done by the end of this year. Is that still reasonable?
That would be the goal.
Okay. And obviously sooner is better.
Yes, if we are able to get them up sooner, it's great. The website has been shifted, so if you take a look at the student services website, we actually have moved things that were on the side to the middle, and you'll see there's a tab in the middle for all program information, so that's where those are.
And one of the things I think we had, and remind me if I'm wrong, Alicia, that we had talked about including was also different kinds of certifications involved for the different programs for the types of teachers and needs of that population, if that's something that would be included in those.
I don't know any more about
that. So we talked about if, so for instance, if it was Bridge, since we didn't know that tonight, saying we have X number of staff with Wilson certification, with LIPS, with whatever, or versus if we're at, talking about the programs at Birch Meadow, for instance, what the certifications are of the different staff and teachers.
I don't know if we would be able to do that because that's a moving target. Like our staff may turn over. We could talk about, we're going to talk about the methodology and different methodology that's utilized in the program. So I don't think we would be able to say this many teachers are certified in a certain area. Because if someone resigns, like updating that document becomes challenging, and I don't want people to rely on it.
But doesn't the district, and if they don't have that, I don't understand it. Do we have an Excel spreadsheet with every staff member?
With every staff member that we have.
Yep.
And then a column that says where they teach, and then what they teach, and what their certifications are. Why can't we have
Right, but that's just their DOE license. One of the questions people have been asking is about like Wilson certification.
Right.
That's not, we don't have a tracking team on that.
Right, but
we absolutely have their license, where they teach, all of that information.
Yep.
We don't have the Wilson certification, or if they had training in LIPS.
Okay, it's not feasible to make a new column that says it.
That's something that was
so discussed. We don't keep it internally, Alicia, just so you know. So that's part of our reporting.
Yep.
So we do have an ability to run reports on all of that, but we don't house all this information ourselves on a separate spreadsheet. We have like employees and like roles.
Okay.
But as far as the certification, like for instance, I have, I think, 8 or 9 certifications. Mm-hmm. We don't keep that because it is a moving target.
Okay.
We don't keep that. We have to report out on it to DESE. So we have all of that in our data system, our information. education system.
Okay.
But we don't keep a separate thing, and then we can't add different fields. They don't allow you to say like, oh, add field 9 for lips, or add field 10.
Right.
The state is very particular about how we house that information. And by law, we have to keep up with that information, and we do. But we don't, we really don't have the staffing, I think, to even manage that at this point. But it is something we could think about.
I just can't imagine we can't just have a Google Drive that lists everybody, and staff can have access and just fill it out. Like, just say like, oh, I'm lips certified, or I have seen stars, or Wilson.
I think that's something the team chairs could start compiling at their own particular buildings. Because they're the ones that work intimately with these folks, so that they have a good idea. And that really will help them as they need to fill positions, saying, you know what, we could really use another Wilson person. You know, we could really use another person who has a little bit more of an ADA background, things like that.
Yeah.
So,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
More folks use
scripture. They're like, the camera's on. Just
so you know, we do have, so RCTV is recording. If we do have questions, make sure you speak loudly so we can hear the questions.
Anything else related to programs, description, features, faculty, methodology, the timing?
No, I mean, I have a hope and a dream, and I'm sorry to say it, but can you please rename the programs? Please, Crossroads, Connections, Compass. Nobody knows what program we're talking about. It's so hard. So just can we maybe...
We just renamed them, but
I know.
The PLC
even if we renamed one, just to take the C out of it. What was the name I came up with?
Oh, I don't remember.
I came up with a great name for, I think, Crossroads. It was, I forget. All right, I just want to throw it out there.
Okay. Do we know them? Let's see if there's anything else we want to go through. Carol, is there anything you want to mention to the community about transition planning? I know there was an announcement.
Yes,
our
interim
should know.
Yep, interim director. The name is going to be Sharon Stewart. I believe Dr. Doherty sent out a message to the whole community. Sharon and I have some days planned over the next few weeks. She'll be meeting with different key staff members, and she was my mentor when I started. Many of our staff are already familiar with her, the different training she's offered. She worked with our district. We had a special ed district data team, and she helped facilitate that, so I think she's going to be great, and I think it's going to be great support for her team.
I don't know, I'm going to be completely honest, I didn't have a lot of time to read the email. Is she full-time for the remainder of the school year, or what does that look like?
So she's working 3 days on-site, and will be available by email and by phone on the other 2 days, but she's working 3 days a week. She'll have a set schedule.
Okay.
And she's only handling 3 days?
Right.
But we have Allison, too, who...
Allison's here, yeah.
So how will that work? Because, I mean, I'm guessing between 3 days, and do you work
two days
as director, like assistant director, or do you...
She'll be able to manage. As Chris said, she's not going to be... She will be available during other times, so her and Allison will have to work out, you know, what day-to-day things will be happening.
Okay. She's just going to cover special ed.
Yes. So, for instance, ELL had formerly been on Carolyn's plate. That was already moved on to mine earlier this year, even before Carolyn's announcement. And then John and I and Carolyn looked through other things. So, for instance, Carolyn's always worked with a behavioral coach. That's something I'm working with. She's worked with the data coach. That's something I'm working with. And I know, so we're really trying to streamline special ed and just keep it special ed so that it's meaningful.
Anything else? Any other questions about transition planning? Okay.
I was just wondering, in the last school committee, the officer mentioned the listing of the teachers, but also the entrance and exit criteria. Has that been talked about or worked on at all? Or?
We talked about the program descriptions, and we are going to work on those. And the goal would be, we talked about prior to coming in, to have those completed by the end of this year.
Would that be different from, under descriptions or different from entrance?
I shared with you the format that we were looking for that had like benchmarks, it had specific things. So the interim director along with Allison and the teachers can take a look at it to see. Our goal was to have a uniform format that addressed key areas that parents had brought forward. So we created a template so that each program would look the same with the same type of information.
Yeah, it would include, we talked about including methodologies, kind of goals of what's included, what we would achieve within that program, certifications. I think what we had landed on, the fact of my notes from last year, I think we're talking about the same thing, using...
Well, I was talking about what the child looks like that is.
Yep, absolutely. So typical learning profile or profile of the students in that cohort, what the goals are to be achieved while they're in that program, that kind of thing. Why don't we cover quickly the meeting dates and workshops? We're still trying to nail down dates, I think, but we're hoping to achieve at least the first part of this year, and then we can go and focus on the report. I know we're trying to do kind of a special ed and Reading 101 kind of workshop. We were thinking it would be great, especially as some new kiddos are being identified as new services as we move into the fall. Having something for parents who are really new to it, it's kind of a really steep learning curve with the language and the acronyms. I think we're going to name it like the TLA as a special ed. Something like that. So we were thinking of doing, like, what is special ed in Reading? And just a quick presentation, maybe, what that is, and then the types of staff, the roles, and then do a little bit of a meet and greet with some of the key staff members and have people network, and then have it kind of end with the networking with the two different team chair, Birch Meadow or wherever. Obviously, we need to hire somebody maybe from there in Birch Meadow before we do that. But I think that was high on the priority list. Do you get that done this fall? And then in addition to that, so we have to do this place workshop. Other things we're going to sprinkle through, we talked about doing a transition planning workshop, maybe in conjunction with another district.
Those were the high priority items.
Well, usually we do IEP for my child, raising rights.
Yeah.
And with the MASPAC membership, I think you get both.
So we'll work on dates with that.
Looking forward to those things. Maybe we can keep in touch on the hiring for Barrows and Birch Meadow and then time in along with that.
And those principals sent out a message to their communities about that.
Okay. All right. Anything else? Other updates before we move into the Partner Bridge program evaluation? Okay. All right.
So it might be helpful to kind of maybe spread out and so that people can see each other.
Sure.
If really this is a discussion.
So I was thinking what might be helpful to just kind of, as a starting point, talk about what the goal was and then what we actually did.
So we last year had engaged with Melissa Orkin from Crafting Minds to do a review of the Bridge program at the Parker Middle School. The goal of that was really to get a sense of how our program was operating and get some recommendations from her. She came out last year through February and March, did observations, met with staff, surveyed parents, and then she compiled a report which we received on May 23rd. Since we've had the report, I've had an opportunity to meet with Ricky Shanklin, the principal at Parker. Allison Wright was the team chair there. I've met with the teachers. We did offer a session with parents, but it was hard for parents to come. Sarah and I talked about it, and really our goal was to do it now because we didn't want to have a sense of families feeling we were trying to engage during the summer when people aren't really available. So this was the date we had established to meet with parents. We have done some planning around an action plan, which I have a draft of. We have reviewed the action plan with the teachers at the Bridge program, as well as the principals at all levels, so elementary, middle, and high school, as well as the team chairs at each of those levels. And so the goal tonight is to do a facilitated discussion with parent perspectives on the report. So this is an opportunity for parents to share their feedback about after they've read the report, and then on the 20th, next Thursday, I will be presenting the findings of the report as well as the action plan to the school community. So I've asked Kathy Lawson, who's the executive director at SEEM Collaborative, to sort of help with the discussion. We've broken it down into
kind of three areas. We were hoping that people who wanted to participate could kind of, we could have a guided discussion or a guided really listening session for us as the administrative team to hear from your perspective, because I've heard from teachers, I've heard from administrators, and now I really wanted to hear from parents the questions that you might have, areas of the report that you agree with, and then things you would like the district to act on. So those are kind of the three rounds we're gonna do. We're gonna kind of go through. If people don't have a copy, I do have extra copies of the report. And really, we are here to listen. So Ricky Shanklin is the principal, Allison Wright is assistant director, Chris Kelly is the assistant superintendent, Kelly Decato is the team chair at Joshua Eaton. Stephanie Lassise is a teacher in the Bridge program at the high school. Shana is a team chair at Killam. So we're really all here to hear the parent perspective about the report. And then ultimately, as I said, next week I will be presenting to the school committee the major findings and then the action plan. So. And so, and Allison is going to project a note-taking format so that as people are asking questions, we're really, as I said, gonna listen and take notes. So we'll have all of those and I can share those with Sarah as well to be able to share out to people the notes from the feedback.
All right, so to be clear, Carolyn, you're not planning on answering questions tonight.
Just
you just want
really
to
really hear those questions because I may be able to incorporate those into my presentation for next week.
So did it, just to start with questions, did anyone, I'm Kathy, by the way, I'm from STEAM Collaborative, and we have a relationship with Reading, our member district. And Carolyn had asked me to come tonight. She was thinking if I focused on asking people's feedback, then they could really pay attention and more focus on listening to what everyone had to say and record everything so that they can consider it as they go forward when they plan a presentation. So just to start, did anyone have any burning questions that came to your mind from the event you wanted to?
I'll start. So I think the two things that were really missing for me, I think there's a lot of great information in the report. There's a lot of rich qualitative data. The biggest thing that jumped out and also was a recommendation as well, and the thing that I think particularly my point is moving forward as we look at doing this in some of the other programs, the quantitative data is missing. So I know that was a recommendation that we need to be doing that, but in order to really understand, you know, it's great, we have a lot of qualitative things documented here and what the staff is doing, but knowing, is this working? We're missing that piece of the data. So we need to match that quantitative data with the qualitative to really get a grasp the effectiveness of the program. So that was the biggest thing to me. And then another thing I think would be really helpful, particularly for the presentation maybe to the school committee or other presentations with parents, presenting the data in charts. So a lot, I know it's a small number, it's not statistically significant, that's fine. But it's not helpful to say 50% of X without the chart, because did all the people answer the question? Was it the full, you know, with all, I can't remember the numbers right now, 7 people, or did that question only apply to 5 people? So being able to see the data would help avoid.
Having a visual really helps.
So those are the two biggest things that jumped out to me, is we get a part of the picture from this. The full picture with matching with the quantitative data would be really helpful. And as we move forward, looking at specialized reading and Elementary Bridge and other programs we want to review, I think that would be really important to include those.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any questions?
I can't remember. When did we get results? Like, I feel like it's been months, and I don't really remember. I don't know. Could we have just a brief overview of what the actual results were? Would that be helpful to anyone?
Yeah, I think it's pretty in-depth.
That's pretty in-depth.
Yeah, it's a lot of information in the report. So we had posted it shortly after we received it on the website. And then that's why when we did the posting, I sort of said, you know, if people could come a
because really the goal, like, yeah.
I
mean, really, it went through different areas of observations of our teachers. So the evaluator observed small group classes and observed inclusion time. She made specific recommendations in each of those areas. She reviewed all of our assessment tools. She reviewed our curriculum, our professional development, and then made recommendations, which when I go through the action plan, I kind of took those recommendations for the action plan, but it's still a draft because I wanted to hear, I haven't heard from this community of stakeholders yet. As I said, I've heard from the teachers, I've heard from the administrative team, and I've heard from our evaluator and wanted parents to have an opportunity to kind of weigh in.
So the Bridge program in the middle school versus the elementary school and the high school, is it very similar, and that's why the middle school was chosen to do the evaluation, and will these results and these changes be across the board for all the schools?
That's part of the action plan.
Okay.
That we'll go into, yeah.
And you're gonna go with that after
yes.
this
part, after this
right?
part, I will review the action plan.
Okay.
In that stuff out to me about is that Melissa Orkin is a leading specialist, and she's evaluating the mathematical portion of this, and I don't know that she's qualified to make the, to make those evaluations about the math program or social studies or so I question the question of it. What is her that's the thing that jumped out to me the most.
Okay, so like how is she qualified? Because she's a reading specialist, so that's
so you'd like
question.
Some more,
yeah,
that's a good
yeah,
question.
Yeah.
Some more information on this is
on
just questions
program,
about her background.
Yeah. And how, I mean, my biggest, personally, my biggest problem is with my students' regular ed, bringing them to regular ed and not having a co-op model. And so that, to me, is more significant with the issues of the program. And so I don't know that she's qualified to look at those as a portion of the program.
Yeah, I mean, I think, again, the biggest thing, and I'm thinking of it from particularly from the lens of moving forward as well, is I think, again, it's great to have an overview of what we are doing and hearing from people, from parents and teachers, if they feel it's being effective, but can't really fully answer that until we have the quantitative piece. So it would be great if part of the action plan was to implement that tracking piece at the middle school and then obviously start doing that before we do the program reviews. At the elementary and then specialized reading to have data points that we can track in aggregate across the different groups.
Okay.
So are we actually,
that,
is what we're doing moving
the
needle?
The recommendation around the benchmarks and progress monitoring.
Yeah, so
that
for the middle school, and obviously before we talked about doing this within specialized reading and at the elementary bridge this year, if we can start implementing some of those data tracking pieces before we do our reviews, that we can integrate them into our program evaluation. And not have to do it after the fact.
I guess as a parent of a child in the Bridge program, and yes, the report was put out in the spring. I might have glanced at it. I don't understand, and I thought I was gonna learn about what is gonna happen with the Bridge program and how it's, this makes no sense to me. Like, I thought you were gonna tell me how it's going and what your thoughts were and how it's gonna look for the kids going to the high school, and I don't know the results. I'm not a teacher.
So your child individual results, I think,
don't
get that. Your child if the gap, if your gap.
Did I get an email about this?
Well, if you're, like, when I look at my own child, when I evaluate the, when I evaluate the program, I like
great.
To see if my if the gap is still the same, if he's still maintaining a two-year reading gap. Just moving forward with the two-year reading gap, then you have to, then I think about the program. So you sort of have to go from that step up. I'm just telling, you know, individually, you know. And then think about the program and what's going on. And is it really working? Is are the children there really progressing, or are they just moving along in their same, this is what we have to sort of figure out. Anyway, and for the peers that I know in my son's class.
And I, as I said, I am gonna share a draft action plan, but I think our goal, when I had talked with Sarah, was we wanted parents to give us feedback. We did have a parent come meet with us in June. We had other parents who had emailed us, and I want parents to have a voice in this. And so that then when we present to school committee, I'm not just presenting, well, the perspective of the administrative team and the teachers. Our parents are a huge stakeholder in this process, and that was our goal, like to give parents this opportunity to say, when we looked at this report, some of the questions we had, when we looked at this report, some of the things we think are the biggest action items for the district are, because you may have a different perspective as a parent than a teacher may have based on this information. So that was really the goal, and I'm happy that I'm going to share the action plan. I just wanted everyone just to make sure that I heard people's voices and we can incorporate that.
I get what you're saying, and I have to say, from a parent perspective of somebody who does have a child with some deficits and understands just a small fraction of this, this is like really weird to me. So I can't give feedback on something that is in a different language, totally. So I don't know if we can sort of, I don't know.
This is not a parent.
Exactly. That's
this is not, this is not anything that I understand. I have been dealing with special ed all of my children's lives. I still don't understand it. And I require somebody to decipher it for me, to help me understand what is the best and appropriate action for Nicholas. So I don't, I'm sorry, this is not my expertise. I don't even, I look at this and I'm completely overwhelmed.
Yeah, so you're not even able to have a question or
no, because I don't even.
And it seems like what stands out to me is Melissa's. She's commenting on a piece of this, the double program and how that is which it does, not just from Parker and from building to building. And I was wondering why, and I know this is probably for a different time, why we're not starting from the ground up. Why are we looking at Parker? Why aren't we looking at Joshua and actually flow into Parker? Parker, to me, is the most stable out of our three of the buildings. I don't understand, you know, and that's just for a different day, I'm sure. But
that's
a
great question.
But it has to be.
Absolutely a great question.
But that's
That's definitely a great question. Because I can talk about that.
It's kind of like, I mean, I understand it because the kids that are at Parker now probably have the worst experience of it, so, you know, but it has to be. I'm confused as to why we're concentrating on the building that's so far in the best shape.
And you also had another comment about the cohesiveness. Yeah. So that feeling that that's something the district needs, if you're saying that's something we need to act upon.
Absolutely.
Okay, so, and that's definitely something she had included in some of the recommendations is sort of that alignment.
Especially from building, even from grade to grade, but from building to building, it's non-existent.
Yeah, that was, I guess, my concern to my initial question was, you know, we have this, and this is what we sort of see in Parker in the program, but how do we know that we have the same deficits across the board? You know, and I can only speak to my son being in Parker. He didn't do Josh Reaton. So I don't know if implementing this across everything is going to fix the issues. It's almost like each school needs to be looked at separately, each program.
That was one of the the biggest things we've been talked about last year was the need to look at each of the programs, but particularly since the largest chunk of children receiving reading services are not in one of the programs, they're in, they get specialized reading outside of one of the existing programs, that that would impact our largest group. And I don't think, again, to the cohesiveness point, that that's consistent across each of the schools necessarily.
Plus, if you start at the elementary, you might not be able to for a gen in the middle school. And the Josh Wheaton is slated to Linda, so if you're on the school committee, Josh Wheaton was for Josh Wheaton to be evaluated to start in the fall, is that what that was, if I remember correctly?
Same.
Right,
I don't
mm-hmm.
remember what it to start in the fall. Carolyn, do you
There's not a funding source to do that currently, so.
There have been discussions, I think, but that's obviously a separate piece of that. We had talked about doing elementary bridge and high school bridge calendar year.
It'd be helpful to move on to the action plan.
Well, I was wanted to just highlight like one thing that Sarah mentioned mm-hmm. on page 8. It says areas for ongoing support. I think both Lauren and Sarah, those two areas.
I'm sorry, can you pick up a little bit?
Page 8. It says areas for ongoing support. And I just wanted to highlight those are the two pieces I think Lauren and Sarah mentioned in terms of agreement, which is the need for an instructional plan that aligns across grade levels, and then two, the need for benchmark assessment. Yeah, I wanted to make sure we didn't miss that because I think you both mentioned those as important from a parent perspective mm-hmm. to a important point.
Yeah, and it does look like if you look at on page 39, I think it is the appendix of what assessments we do have in the district, making sure we look at those. It looks like we do mm-hmm. have a fair number of what we would need. I have to be honest, I meant to look and see if there were ones that were missing that parents might be interested in or the staff might be interested in making sure we have access to.
I think on page, let me go back, she did mention too
yeah.
that she felt we were missing. It is on page 23. She has recommendations for assessment inventory.
Yeah.
Yeah, the tower and the RAN RAS. Yep. So she has those two.
So do you think it would be helpful, Carolyn, to go into what the action plan, and then maybe it will spark some additional kind of comments, and we can go back.
We can go back to the action items so people can vote if you wanted to. Pass that around. This is a copy of the action item.
Try to make your video
and it comes off.
into budgets, do you, in the June JE now?
We don't currently have a funding source, we're waiting on some additional grants.
So Linda, do I recall printed that, that was part of, and Alicia, you can correct me too, it was on the goals for the year, for superintendent's goals to do the program reviews of all of the schools as well, right?
And the interim director may work closely with the new chief financial officer and identify somewhere in the budget to make that move. I just don't currently, I haven't been able to identify that, and with someone else coming in, they may be able to identify a source for that. It's definitely a priority for the superintendent, we just need to determine how to fund it.
It's a stupid question, but why wasn't elementary done first? Why was Parker done first?
That's a really great question, and I'll present that when I talk about it at school committee. I'm happy to talk about it here. Because we had done so much work with Landmark School and really put a lot of resources into Parker, we wanted to see if the work that we had done had the outcome that we were looking for so that we could use a similar model at elementary and at high school. So we had, so if you kind of look historically, we had used some resources from grant funding and professional development to support the teachers at Parker over the last 3 years, and we wanted to see if that work really had the impact you want. Similar to with students, you do an intervention and then you want to see did it have the impact that you had hoped for by doing an evaluation from someone outside. So your comment that it's the most stable program was exactly why, because we made some really specific decisions about how we supported the teachers there, the type of professional development, the type of consultation that Parker had received. And if that report was positive, we could then replicate those actions at elementary and at high school. So that was the reasoning why. And it did give us some good information about the work that needs to happen at Josh Wheaton and then some continued work at the high school. But we've already started that work at the high school. The high school is following a similar trajectory to what Parker has done.
Do we have any assessment data on these kids at the high school?
That's a great question. And we put together assessment data.
Because do we know the year of the kids? Like I am a little behind the eight ball. I didn't do homework, I'm sorry.
Kids that graduated from the bridge program, how many of them went off to, say, a four-year college? Yeah.
Or any kind of data, like, you know, SAT scores, or MCAS.
MCAS.
Just somebody to tell you how they're doing, or something.
Yeah.
It's not done by program, it's done by entire special ed cohorts. So it's done by grade level, and only if you have more than 20 students do they report out. So any program or any grade that has less, so like for instance, if third graders school had less than 20 kids, they may not report out on that. So it's not as complete as you would think, but there is data for sure.
Yes.
SAT data is a little trickier for us because those individual scores, we get like our whole school scores, but we don't really track them and they're protected. So we can't really release those. But MCAS data, we can as long as it's not self-identifying. But we could look into that, especially for our special ed data. It might give us an overall view of looking at like before we did some of this work and then after and following those cohorts, we could try to drill down to that.
So what about children who are not in the bridge program that have language-based issues as well? Like, are those being tracked? I feel like it's all bridge. Like, if you have a child who has problems that is not in the Bridge program, reading problems or language-based problems, how are those being tracked in being utilized to help make the program, the reading program, stronger for all schools?
So what data are we looking at for students who are receiving reading services who are not in the Bridge program?
Correct.
And how are we using that data to improve literacy?
Because my guess is that there are an equal number of children that are not in the Bridge program that need these services than there are in the Bridge program.
So are there any questions? We can do similar around the action plan. Are there questions that people have on the action plan? So again, mostly this is taken right from the report into the action.
One of the things I was, I guess maybe a recommendation would be, so it looks like the time frames, and I know resources and all that is a huge factor, but in terms of identifying benchmarks and actually implementing those, it looks like we're doing the plan this year and looking to implement it next year. I'd say I would encourage the district to try to get in at least one assessment by the end of this year so that we have something to compare to moving forward if we do a reevaluation. You can at least have something to compare against as they're moving forward.
For the progress monitoring?
For progress monitoring. I know, maybe not realistic, but I think that that could be a smart thing for us to do and be able to assess what are the areas that we're doing well at, mm-hmm. and identify the things that maybe we're not doing as well. And then again, I think, again, encouraging that not just within the Bridge program, but any child receiving specialized reading services, that we're doing consistent benchmarking using our reference tests with them. So that we can identify where are the things that we should be focusing on versus, you know, we can kind of streamline and fine tune where we're focusing our attention and budget and resources. So that was the biggest thing that jumped out at me. Mm-hmm. And then some other things, again, I know resource constraints are a huge thing, but some of the lower hanging fruit seems like we're taking a longer time to implement, such as the program descriptions, especially considering how long we've been talking about doing them since, I think, when was the Walker report? 2015, we've been talking about those. So again, I know it's a pain, it's hard, you're herding cats trying to get different people to come together around certain things, but if we can prioritize getting some of those things done and published and off the plate and not pushing it off further, that might help as well.
One of the things that, I'm sure this covers, you know, whatever you wanted to cover, but like, typically when I think of an action plan, I want to see I guess similar to what Sarah was saying, the things we're doing well, and then where are the gaps, and then how are we addressing them? You know what I mean? Just the format of presentation, which is probably what you're going to do anyway, but, you know, like, these were our needs, mm-hmm. and now this is how we're accomplishing them. I think that would further my understanding.
Just to clarify too, so when we're talking about the program descriptions, there was an iteration of describing programs and renaming them that was over the last year, 2 years, and that my understanding was that that was going to continue with the work on the exit and the entrance criteria.
We worked through meetings with the CPAC to identify areas that parents were looking for in a program description. So we put together a format at the end of last year that we want each program. So every program was doing it a little different. So we have PowerPoints, we have some brochures, we have all these different things. And so we wanted to make sure we were hitting the key components for each program.
So on top of what was the first iteration,
yes,
of that.
Because it does involve, we're asking them not only to just describe their students and the type of program, we had specific things we want them to do. And some programs are further along in that than other programs. Thank you. Yeah, Allison might have a copy so that you can see what we're projecting.
And also the timeline for when we expect these items to be fully implemented, because, you know, we have something into the 2020, but it just is continued. So when, what's the expectation for final completion?
So something more specific.
Yeah.
It just seems like it's backwards. When I looked at, for instance, in LRD, when I look at the entrance criteria on other schools' websites, it's almost all the same. And this asking for, you know, discussing with the profilers in our group and with the teachers, and it seems like it's backwards. I don't understand why profile isn't typical. I mean, I don't understand why the entrance criteria isn't more boilerplate. This is what you're presenting to your teachers instead of you just talking about as a group what we think is going to be in this group. My biggest problem with the program is that, for instance, my student may be in the classroom with a child who's not supposed to be there. Their first issue is not dyslexia. So that presents a problem with his moving forward, with others moving forward. So now you have this group, and this is what happens. Now you have this group that travels together year by year. This one child may be holding this one back, or frustrating this one trying to get forward. And by the time you all get in high school, the kids in the bridge program with cognitive delays, other issues, it's like a really invasive. So nobody's learning at that point. So that's why I just am frustrated with it. I have a Walker report that's 11 years old that I got when my son was in, asking for the same thing. So it's frustrating. It's frustrating for me to have my student in the classroom with another kid who I know is light years below him. And this is where the failure of the program starts, with the groupings that I'm correct and not. I know it sounds terrible to talk, you know, say that, but that's reality, you know, and that's the biggest issue. So I feel that the entrance criteria should be given to the teachers and the staff, not the staff making it up, you know. It should be already boilerplate.
Yeah, no, I hear your concern. It's not having staff make it up. They need to be part of that process with some guidance from the administrative team about what needs to be.
Too. I don't even think we should ask parents. I think it should be asked not even of administration, but, of experts.
Experts
in dyslexia.
But it should be a working group as well.
You know what I'm saying? There are people that know more about this than you and I and anybody in the room. And that's who should be deciding who goes in the LLP classroom and who's eligible for the LLP classroom. If the criteria starts getting so broad, then you end up with a class that's never going to, it's a bad formula. It's not going to work. As you can see in Josh Weaver, that's the biggest problem over there. And then you have teachers that can't handle that large array of learning over there, and it ends up being a mess. And I know this isn't a place to stop at, but this is what I'm talking about. This is why we're harping so much in the entrance, exit and entrance criteria. It hinges, lays the base for success or failure, or to get the program to get these kids grouped where they need to be. You know, it's just frustrating.
Okay.
sort of stems from, and it's Sarah, is it, what's your
Lauren.
Name?
Lauren.
Lauren, I'm so sorry, I'm trying to catch up. So part of, from the school committee perspective, and funding and resources, and one of the questions that crosses my mind is how do we deal with the evolution of different and changing needs of different children year to year? Because there isn't really necessarily a stability. The children go through different things at different times, and I hear about parents who have kids that are changed schools or changed classes, and it's sort of dependent on what the needs, the most priority needs of the children are.
It depends on the group. I understand what you're saying, but it depends on the group. But dyslexic is always an older, high IQ, no cognitive learning issues. There are certain criteria for certain, but those programs, if you don't adhere to that criteria, the program's going to fail. We're seeing the evidence of that with Josh Wheaton. This is what I'm talking about. And I understand what you're saying. It's such a
It's really a question.
But
so how do you deal with that evolution?
There are definite criteria for definite issues, and that if you claim to have an LLD, it should really look true LLD and host the children that are truly fit into that program. Because you can't pull from here and there and have teachers that really are not equipped to handle it and hope it for the best. I've lived through the Josh Wheaton thing. This is what's happening. That's the crux of the problem over there. And we're starting to see it now. Everybody's starting to understand. But that's the biggest problem. You have to identify those groups and service that group. And you can't.
And that's why Landmark and Carol are so good at what they do, because they have honed in on that group. They know exactly what those kids need. And they don't waver from that subset of kids. It's always they have this criteria and there's no wavering. Is that fair?
Yeah, and then you have to hire the people that understand the criteria and understand how to teach it. And right now it's like this program, and that's what I'm talking about with the cohesiveness, this program, I personally depend on one or two teachers that really know dyslexia. And the other ones try their hardest and really want to do it and really want to be that. But right now, and it's like I can't, from a parent point of view, I can't worry that the next person next year from now is not going to know what they're doing and has all good intentions but really does not know. And that's painful. So that cohesiveness is just, you can't have somebody go for a weekend lips training and say, okay, take my kid, teach them everything they know, it's just not gonna work. So that cohesiveness between all of our teachers and making them the best they can, or understanding what they're teaching within that program is so important. Until we have that, and like I said, Packer is definitely the best building in the town, but it's not there yet. And until you have that and understand that you need that, it's just not going to work. And it's just, and I'm sorry I'm spouting, but it's just frustrating.
Just to add to that point about the kids meeting certain criteria, my son went to Landmark Summer School for 6 years, and he had to be tested every single year to get into that program, in addition to having teachers within the classroom and Reading school systems fill out an evaluation to ensure that, he didn't have ADHD, that he didn't have behavioral issues, that his IQ was high. And if he didn't meet those criteria, he wasn't accepted to the program, because all these kids had to be willing and capable of learning Landmark's way. And so just to your point, I can speak to experience on their acceptance, and that's just for the 5-week summer school program.
And it's in public school.
Right. It has to be broader.
That is definitely why it works.
Yeah. And, if you want it to work,
it has to be rigid. It has to be rigid.
The right kids in the right programs with the right teachers, and it's, I hate to say it, but we shouldn't have LLD in high school. You know what I mean? We shouldn't have kids in LIPS program in high school. They should be done by me. I'm sorry, I got off. So I'm on the top.
topic for now.
Are there other questions or action items from the action plan?
I'm curious why only certain schools are involved. So Parker, RMHS, JP's, Parker. To Maura's point, there are kids with disabilities.
This was really focused on the Bridge program, so that was really why, and there were certain items that were more Parker specific and were aligned. So when there's the area where it talks about the review of instructional practices, that's a goal that the school has. So it made a lot of sense to align with exactly what they're doing and to document that.
Will it eventually be pushed out?
That's everything. Yeah. That's why you model those practices. Well, which is also doing it. They're just at a little bit different of a level than us right now because we started it with our Bridge teachers, with our content teachers who have Bridge students in their classes. So we're just expanding it to the rest of the staff.
One of the other things I'd love to see in the future, I know this is ridiculous, but it's not ridiculous. I wish it could be like this. If we could have truly co-taught classes in middle school and actually throughout the Bridge kind of program. And not just teacher in the classroom modifying it, but a true co-taught classroom for science and social studies. Because they're not cure and they don't decide social studies, you know, it would be beneficial for all the kids.
Can I ask a question of parents, just on one of the action items, thinking about, you know, coffee with parents, structures that you've seen that have been successful, that we can model that after, kind of how that looks, or things that we don't want to see at those, at that coffee, if we do want to see, we can use our time the most effectively.
Sarah, did you go to coffees?
No.
Lauren, did you ever go?
For the, those were specifically for the middle school, the freeze at lunch again.
Oh, I think so. Is that what you're specifically?
So this one, there's a coffee in here that involves
Joshua Eaton, we did one at Parker last year. Could we have a lot of people?
I knew the Joshua Eaton, so I'm just trying to see what
parents like.
Are you thinking of having that kind of a longer term plan of so here's the short term and kind of midterm objectives, longer term objectives of we've talked about, you know, identifying what assessments we're going to use, we're going to implement them, and along with all these other things as well, at what point we're going to reevaluate, you know, is that in what makes the most sense? Is it 2 years? Is it whatever that you know administration identifies as and staff identifies as a great point to look back at what we've done and kind of make course corrections, not waiting, you know, too long until we've gone too far down the road, and then deciding that didn't work or this did work. Those shorter, like, kind of, so including the longer term plans, and then obviously that would include, in my mind, the rolling out the program evaluation and assessments and all that thing to specialized reading across the other elementaries and other middle and school as well. I think that will be a big question for a lot of parents of like, okay, this is great that this applies to the Bridge programs at these schools. Now what? What are we going to do with that? How are we going to look at it and evaluate it again? And then what about the other kiddos?
Well, I also think it is more of a plan of how do you evaluate each program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I have trouble hearing. So do you have a thought at all on time frame for that? Is that even been contemplated?
Well, we did the Walker review as a more comprehensive
comprehensive review. So I think the question will be, you know, do you want to do something now that we have this, taking this Parker done? Do you look at something every 3 years? You know, where you look at each program every 3 years? I think it's just, I think that's a great recommendation, and I need to think about, you know, what is the time frame? But that's a more comprehensive.
I'm sorry, my question was more tailored to the rollout of the other schools. Like, is there a time frame for implementation for beyond the schools that you mentioned here?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think my recommendation would be that we create sort of a plan of evaluating all programs and what's the time frame. So are we doing every program every 3 years? So every year we're evaluating different programs.
I think on a 3 year cycle. Two separate, so there, and we had talked about implementing the program evaluations, correct me if I'm not understanding your question correctly, for the elementary bridge, for high school and specialized reading within this next school year previously, but we had talked about we need to identify budget for that. And then the separate consideration of now once we've done these program reviews, once so the Parker one's done, the next evaluation point, so kind of two separate.
So when do you go back? Like how frequently are we looking?
So we're implementing all these things and making sure we're continuously evaluating. But in addition to that, we also need to map out when we're actually going to do the initial program evaluations for the other programs.
Is it something that the CPAC could maybe create like a master calendar in Google that we, like we work with Carolyn or whoever, staff changes and ideas get lost. And so having a master calendar on the CPAC Google Drive that, you know, we've sat down with the director and we're going to hopefully always have that CPAC drive.
Mm-hmm. And all the information.
So, I mean, we have all our documents there, and it's like, you know, if you are no longer chair in 2027, you can hand it off to the next person.
You don't think all that's done. Yeah, I mean, we're certainly happy to work with the administration on an evaluation plan. Like, what does that look like? What are the time frames for short, medium, and long-term goals? And, you know.
And it doesn't have to be. I mean, I don't think this is rocket science we're talking about. We're talking about blown-out dates and saying, you know, these are soft dates that maybe we can make hard or something.
So there has been no evaluation of the high school bridge program, correct?
We have not formally evaluated the program.
So what about our kids that are in Parker and in eighth grade and are going to transition potentially to the bridge program? How do we know that it's going to be an appropriate program for them to even transition into? We've had such great experience at Parker, and I think they get what they need so far. But I guess I'm worried about next year. I mean, is it still going to be here? Is it going to change? Are you going to have a turnover of staff again? How are we going to know that it's okay for our kids to go here? Are there people that we can talk to? Can we look at the program? Can we look at the statistics again?
More extensive of a transition process for students moving from eighth grade to ninth grade within the bridge program. So we offered several different opportunities where we had an open house here. So parents got to come here. The team chairs at the high school did a presentation. Then we went on a tour of the building, saw the different spaces. We went into Mrs. Cease's classroom. we did very brief observations of an English class, and then we went into a learning center within the bridge program. And then we offered a time for parents to ask questions. So it was an open session where a lot of the teachers in the bridge program came down and asked the team chairs and the teachers questions. We also set up a time where students came over. We did a field trip with the bridge students, and that was another time to really get them familiar. So that's something that we just actually started talking about. just today I was talking about it with one of the team chairs about trying to plan that out for the year.
We have also had Landmark consulting with the high school, and many of the high school staff have participated in similar trainings as Parker. We utilize our consultant to work with all the teachers, and they have been meeting vertically for 3 years, really trying to align how the programs are. So I know Stephanie and the teachers at the high school work very closely with the teachers at Parker to make sure there is an alignment.
So we don't know if there's been any big issues that have come up between transitioning from middle school bridge program to the high school bridge program?
Nothing that at this point that is a major issue that we've had to address. Our biggest concern 2 years ago is we didn't have someone who was trained in a reading program, but that's been resolved. We added a staff internally who is now Wilson certified, and then we hired someone as well. So we have been able to rectify that, and so that has been really positive for the high school. So that was a big issue when I first came on board, but that hasn't been an issue for a couple of years.
I feel like I'm saying the same thing over and over. I feel that students in other elementary schools, like you were saying, feel that they've really sort of been left out of the process. And I think that, you know, with a lot of parents that I've been speaking with, there's a need to have students evaluated earlier, and that, you know, someone else said this, the hope is that they're not needing these services in high school. I think we need to really focus more on the younger students as well, and the parents who are in other elementary schools that have children with these issues just feel like, you know, everyone's talking about it, this one program, which is great, and I realize why you're doing it, but it doesn't seem like that information is being extrapolated out into the other schools. And so I do think, I know that the action item is meant for the bridge program, but it does need to have some expansion.
Response to intervention, that whole approach was used in throughout all the elementary schools in the early grades. Is that still the case?
Yep. So we use the MTSS framework, so it's called the multi-tiered system of support. So it's similar in that we provide interventions for students when they are struggling. So we have reading specialists that are general ed, which was kind of some of the confusion. So elementary and middle school have reading specialists who are general ed personnel who provide reading support to any student who is struggling with reading. We also have tutors, so we have general education tutors for reading and math as ways to support students who are struggling. So there are.
We also have school-based data teams. So several times a year we get together. They do it more often at the school level, but even district-wide. We bring the data of looking at certain benchmark assessments, and we'll be starting that soon, where we're really pinpointing like who are our most critical care cases, and we test everyone, even if they're in special ed. So they'll be having similar benchmarking done. But yeah, the response to intervention, in addition to what she said, we also have interventionists at the two Title I. We have two Title I targeted assistance schools, which currently are Joshua Eaton. So we also have intervention. We actually upped the time of interventionists in both of those schools this year. With me coming on, I'm managing the Title I program, and we took that money and allocated it for direct service.
Those Title I teachers, special ed teachers?
They could be, they don't have to be. They're interventionists, so they're grant funded and they're like tutored, but they're tutors, but they're actually trained teachers. Some of them have reading backgrounds, some of them have special ed backgrounds. I just hired an interventionist this week that will be starting at Joshua Eaton, and she has a special ed background.
Just so you're aware, because it was before you happened, when you were hired. When I was at Joshua Eaton, mm-hmm. the Title I teachers that came in were not generally not special ed, and they wouldn't on the IEP, so they were sending out to most vulnerable readers, and so the all the kids are on IEPs, weren't eligible for this essential.
At Josh Eaton, we're using the interventionists only for math support. So that was a building-based decision. So they're not working with reading at all. They're only working on math support. But the same thing, we're looking at the benchmark math scores and then figuring out what groups look like that from that.
Since we're talking about assessment and benchmarking, and as maybe as a school committee member or as a parent, we're talking about the topic of all this work about evaluating, figuring out, or making progress, my mind automatically goes to, has the district put any thought into implementing an early screening process? I mean, I know the legislation failed currently, or it's still stuck in the House, I should say, but there's hope. And we're putting a lot of time and effort, and you know, we're talking about kiddos being in high school, still needing reading support. If we had identified them in pre-K as being at high risk and most likely having a language-based learning disability, and were able to, you know, implement LIPS in an intensive way, or like, we wouldn't need to be providing such intensive services later on. I don't know if any thought has been given to that, but I certainly think
that was a big question.
It was great to have the Department of Education here today.
Tomorrow.
We're doing a lot of great work. It would be nice to say, hey, look at what else we can do. Another great thing Reading is ahead of the curve on, and you know, we're in one of like 8 states that doesn't have legislation currently. Yeah. It would be nice to say, hey, look, we know this needed to be done. Let's get it on our roadmap, and maybe that's part of the strategic plan moving forward of, we're looking at, we're benchmarking, we're evaluating, and we're going to implement a screening process before we're required.
We did start conversations last year with the elementary principals,
it's definitely on our plan for this year to look at that. As an early childhood educator myself, I can't agree more. Yeah. Really is definitely that.
Absolutely.
And all the FNP chapters and updating all the schools.
So we ordered the third edition of Fountas and Pinnell, and every classroom now has one. We're training the trainers right now. And on the October 5th release day, every special educator, reading specialist, and classroom teacher in the elementary schools will be trained in the new edition.
So will they redo the benchmarking?
So they're actually going to hold off on the benchmarking until after the October 5th date, so that we're literally starting over. Like, this is how...
I know some schools are doing benchmarking right now.
So I think one is because they were already using we can talk offline. They were told not to.
We're doing it now. I just want to make sure what we're doing.
They were told not to hold off until we did the training. There was one school that had already been using the third edition, so I believe that they have been given the green light since we're still rolling this out to start with benchmarking. But we've asked all the other
questions.
We've asked the other classrooms to hold off on opening them up, so because they are different. They're very different than the last editions. And our new humanities director, humanities coordinator at the elementary level, has been trained and has been a trainer in this program. So she's training everyone, and she came from Lowell, and they pushed out the third edition to Lowell in the last couple of years. So
light's telling.
So we're really excited about that. We've got a plan.
Am I recalling correctly that there is a crosswalk chart? I know it's not exact science, but
there was a crosswalk to the older version.
Right, so version
that you
two,
could, but it wasn't easy, and it wasn't easy. I mean, I've seen it. And the biggest part that really has changed is there's a whole, aside from just the actual reading scores, the new kits have much better comprehension, which I think that's the key. Like, you know, if these kids can read it and they're just sounding out words, but they don't understand what they're reading, we need to start keeping track of that and noticing that. So the third edition is really completely revamped. So the crosswalk helped you with actually like the new standards with the new scores and all that. This score means this. And
I think I'm just thinking ahead to those November meetings too.
We'll be all set to
like, wait, what happened? Why is my child's reading level lower?
Yeah,
it's
so they will be.
Say,
they're definitely more rigorous than they have been. I think we will be writing something in my blog and things like that about that. There's a lot of talk about not emphasizing so much on levels, but you know, really starting to talk more about the quality and the quantity of books that kids are reading. We got kind of into that alphabetical approach to reading instruction, what level you on? Are you on, you know, J or K or, so we're definitely gonna craft some sort of information so parents are understanding that we're using it, but we're also talking about, like, kids shouldn't even know what level they're on. This is an adult topic. Parents can know and kids can know, I mean, adults, teachers should know, but you know, when I hear kids say, well, I'm on like J, I'm like, what does that even mean to a child? So, you know, the Fountas and Pinella are really trying to say, don't even, like, kids shouldn't even see the level of the books. So we're trying to get away from some of that.
Other questions? If something, you review all of this over the next few days, I'm working on my presentation for school committee. Mm-hmm. So if there's something, which was why I wanted to get input, is to say if there's something that as you digest all this or you leave, you want to email me your thoughts, that would be great, like preferably by Monday or Tuesday, probably not the day before, but yes.
Are you going to give the school committee like a Cliff Notes version?
Yes. That's the presentation. So the presentation is the highlights. No, in the Cliff Notes. So in the school committee, in the school packet is going to be a copy of this full review and the action plan with draft off of it. So now that I have heard from all of you, now I need to digest it, edit the action plan, and put that into it. Then I'm going to have a presentation that will go through the highlights, and some of the things you guys have brought up are really helpful for me to add to the presentation. Some of the questions you have, that's why I really wanted to get the feedback, because it's helpful to know ahead of time so I can address those things that maybe I hadn't thought of that you as parents have questions about as stakeholders. So then integrating that. So as, you know, the next few days, if there are other thoughts that you have of something I need to address or a question you have about the action plan, please email me or call and share that with me. And so that way I can incorporate that. My goal is to have the action plan, hopefully by the end of the day tomorrow, updated. It needs to go in the packet, which I think is going out at noon on Monday. So the action plan, feedback on that, like, we need to turn around pretty quickly. The presentation, I can tweak up until, I mean, I'd like to have it somewhat finalized, so like 6:45 on Thursday. Probably not the best for me, but if you get, you know, get input earlier, you know, again, it can be email, you can, you know, give me a call, because I do want to make sure that I'm hitting on things that from a parent perspective, you guys have identified as this is something the district needs to address. So.
You can also send those to me if you prefer to do that. I'm happy to filter those as well. I know sometimes some people aren't as comfortable giving direct feedback, so happy to do that as well.
Is it possible for you to send your presentation to Sarah so she can kind of eyeball it? Because I feel like Sarah has a really good handle on it, and we're really lucky for that.
A school committee is no longer on Mondays.
Thursday nights.
Monday.
Same place.
Yes, and it's here. It's no longer
Thursday night.
Every Thursday, we're just going to meet right here. Just to get into practice. Just every Thursday. Put it on your calendar.